morning and welcome to our time of worship. I'm David Yim, the Director of Youth Ministry here at the Centerville Presbyterian Church in Fremont, and I'm glad you're able to join us this morning. Our call to worship is from Isaiah chapter 43, and it reads, "This is what the Lord says, He who created you, Jacob, He who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. Let us worship the Lord in spirit and in truth." Now Deacon Laura Mares will now lead us in our opening prayer.
Heavenly Father, you are our light, our salvation, and our strength. We come to you this morning to worship you and to praise your name. Forgive us for allowing fear to rule us, as it does much more than we care to admit. This fear has 1,000 names, but your perfect love casts it out. And so we come to you in this hour as a people who need the breath of your spirit to blow through us, the brightness of your light to shine in us and around us, the fire of your love to bring us to the life right now, and the sight and sound of your glory to bring forth hallelujah of praise. We pray for this hour of worship that we would sense your presence in each home that is connected to this service today. Remind us that we are not alone, that you are with us and will never leave us. So revive us as your people. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Joe Lynn will now lead us as we sing God's praises. "Be still, my soul. A mighty fortress is our God, and it is well with my soul."
The psalmist reminds us that God is our refuge and strength, always ready to help in times of trouble. God says to us, "Be still and know that I am God." Sing this with us.
Be still, my soul.
Through Heavenly Father, your thoughts are not our thoughts, nor are your ways our ways. And yet we long to live in your way. We want to be faithful followers of your Son, Jesus, but we fall short. We get distracted. We are prone to wander. Forgive us for our careful thoughts, our selfish deeds, our empty speech, and the words we have used to wound others. In your mercy, forgive us. God of grace, cleanse the sin from our lives. Lead us to a deeper experience of your love. Inform what we say. Strengthen our courage. Increase our faith and trust in you. We pray all this in the name of your Son, our living hope. Amen. Hear the assurance of pardon. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Friends, receive the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Now, Jo Lynn, our executive minister, has several announcements about the continuing ministry of our church and its outreach to serve the community of Fremont.
Thank you, Lynette, and thank you for joining us online at CPC today. We are so grateful for the ability to stay connected with one another through Zoom, and we look forward to the day when we'll be able to gather once again in a place of worship and to pray and fellowship with one another. But in spite of our physical separation, ministry at CPC continues during this season. Children under the direction of Christy Lee Yim and youth ministries led by David Yim carry on during this shelter-in-place season. Check out cpcfremont.org website for more information. Thursday evening online prayer session resumed May 14th with a new start time, and it will continue this Thursday, May 21st, at the 7 o'clock start time. Check your email or what's posted on the website, cpcfremont.org, for more information. This note, the church, CPC, has formed a team to help grocery shop and or pick up medications for those most at risk for COVID-19. If you or someone you know has a need, you can submit your request by emailing or calling the church office. For more information about Centerville Presbyterian Church's ongoing ministries, check our website, cpcfremont.org. Today, we're excited to announce that this past Friday, our future senior pastor, Sam Not Near Us, was presented to the EPC, that's the Evangelical Presbyterian Church Presbytery of the Pacific Southwest, for his ordination exams, and was overwhelmingly approved for ordination into our presbytery. Mark your calendars, as there will be an ordination installation service for him on Sunday, August 9th at 5 p.m. More information will be coming. Now, a word from Pastor Sam Notnieris.
Hey, Centerville, we are so excited about coming. Thank you for praying. I passed my ordination. And right after the Zoom call, I saw Greg and Marcia in the window, and they had tears coming down their faces. And so I was so honored. I called them to say thank you for their legacy and everything that they have invested in you and in this process. And then they prayed for our family, they prayed for you, and they prayed for our future together. So I just want to say I am so excited about the future and the story that God is writing for all of us in Fremont.
We interrupt this announcement for Happy Dance!
Happy Dance! Woo!
We cannot wait to meet everybody!
And thank you, Sam, for that great video. Let me remind you to stay online at the conclusion of our worship service today to be connected to a fellowship group. That's an opportunity to catch up with members of the CPC church family. Ian Pagador comes now to read today's scriptures from John chapter 14, verses 15 to 21. Ian?
Listen to the word of God. If you love me, keep my commands, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever. The Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them.
I'm preaching today on God's cure for loneliness. Last Sunday was Mother's Day, and one of our members sent me a very encouraging email this week thanking me for the sermon, how it helped him to be more grateful for being blessed with a godly mother. It made my day. And he also sent along a story, which he said I could use for Mother's Day next year, but it's too good of a story to wait a whole year. So here's how it goes. There was a little boy who forgot his lines in a Sunday school presentation. His mother was in the front row to prompt him. She gestured and formed the words silently with her lips, but it didn't help. Her son's memory was a total blank. Finally, she leaned forward and whispered, "I am the light of the world." The little boy beamed and said, "My mother is the light of the world." And then there's the story of the mother who had three notoriously unruly youngsters. She was asked if she would have children if she had to do it all over again. "Yes," she replied, "but not the same ones." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, creator of the universe and of everything that is good, we thank you for making man and woman in your image and for the joy and challenge of parenting and for the gift of mothers and dads. We pray especially for moms and dads and kids and every single person present who may be going right now through a bout of loneliness or disappointment or depression. Some are getting stir crazy as we stay in our homes. Some are literally all alone, the only person present in this time of shelter in place. I pray a special blessing on those who are lonely, that the words I am about to preach will be anointed by the power of your Holy Spirit to bring comfort and healing and challenge to all of us. For we ask this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Some of you will remember reading in your English Lit class Samuel Taylor Coleridge's epic, The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. For these words are said by the ancient sailor, alone, alone, all alone, alone on a wide, wide sea, and never a saint took pity on me in my soul in agony. I began my sermon with that quotation because loneliness is increasingly recognized as a major public health crisis that is on the rise and impacting people of all ages, and it is a problem worldwide. Loneliness. It's one of those feelings we don't like to talk about. After all, when a spouse or a close friend asks and wants to know what's wrong, it's difficult to say, I'm just feeling lonely right now. We fear the other person might take it personally and be hurt or offended, so we choose to keep our lonely feelings to ourselves, typically. But you can see it in people's eyes, even in the way they walk, if you are observant. Loneliness. It's something we all experience from time to time. Some of you are single moms. Some have lost a spouse. Some have outlived their children. Think of the mothers who are estranged from their children and their dads. As mothers and fathers, we feel it when kids leave home, when a loved one dies, when no one else seems to understand our feelings. It can happen in the midst of a joyous crowd. Loneliness can strike powerfully and unexpectedly, and it is much more common affliction than we might expect. In fact, some statisticians claim that loneliness is the single most common disease of human experience the world over. Every child psychologist will tell you that the fear of abandonment is the greatest fear of all. And it's not just a problem of pre-adolescence, it's a fear in adulthood and at the end of our lives. Talk to a man or a woman who's gone through a divorce, or talk to their children. Loneliness is a worldwide phenomenon. War brings loneliness. Epidemic disease brings loneliness. Famine brings loneliness. Have you ever visited a senior citizen's home? I read this week several reports on the worldwide phenomenon of loneliness. One report was on the forgotten generation, elderly women and loneliness. It was in the Journal of American Geriatric Studies. But it cuts across all segments of society and in all cultures. Loneliness is the single most common experience among college students. Loneliness and the loss of hope is the single most frequent cause of suicide in college and in high school, and even sometimes increasingly in junior high. And all the hours we spend on the internet or working alone with our computers with little or no human interaction is not helping much. Men, in fact, may not even be conscious of their loneliness and isolation. In his book, The Hazards of Being Male, The Myth of Masculine Privilege, Herb Goldberg asked adult men if they had any close friends. Most of them seemed surprised by the question and usually responded, no. Why? Should I? So, in the midst of shelter in place, I want to wrestle with this worldwide phenomenon this morning and prayerfully suggest an approach on how to deal with it. So, just what is loneliness? A professor of English literature would probably say loneliness is the noun for the adjective lonely, which the unabridged Random House Dictionary defines as being lonely, solitary without company, companionless, destitute of sympathetic or friendly companionship or relationships, a lonely exile, affected with or characterized by a depressing feeling of being alone. Characterized by a depressing feeling of being alone. If you need a definition, that's probably the best one. But if you've ever experienced loneliness, you don't need a definition. You will remember the feeling, the isolation, the estrangement, the bitter solitude. I'm not talking about solitude as such of being quiet and alone. Solitude is a neutral term. You can either be happy or sad in your solitude. I find solitude an important and necessary thing. My most creative moments are when I'm alone in solitude between 12 midnight and 2 a.m. But to be lonely, to have a sense of loneliness, is to tip the scale in the direction of sadness, of hurt, and disappointment. It was such a feeling of loneliness that Jesus knew his closest followers would experience when he left this earth, and so on the very evening that Jesus instituted the Last Supper, he attempted to prepare them in the 14th chapter of John, which was read just a moment ago. "I will not leave you comfortless," Jesus said. "I will come to you." Jesus said that the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, will come to sustain you so that when you think you are all alone, I will be there. When you think you've been abandoned, or literally, the Greek word here means orphan, and the NIV gets it right. When you think you have been orphaned, I will be there. Comfortless. The original word in Greek also implies isolation and desolation and abandonment, utter loneliness. Now, the word comfortless in modern usage has lost those terrible overtones. To many people today, to be comfortless is to drive on the 680 freeway toward Walnut Creek when the air conditioner doesn't work. But what our Lord is speaking about here is nothing less than the deepest emotional pit into which we can fall, the lost loneliness of the soul, cut off from man, cut off from God. It's more than being incarcerated in a prison. It's more than being a widow or a widower. I've experienced that. It is more than being a shut-in or in a nursing home. To be comfortless is to be like Job, crying out in his agony, "Oh, that I knew where I might find him." To be comfortless is to descend into the hell where all other prayer is blotted out by the terrible words, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And Jesus says, "I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you." These words which Jesus spoke to his disciples are, in their deepest sense, the whole gospel in a single sentence. These words speak to our fundamental condition as human beings. To be comfortless, to be orphaned, ultimately is to be cut off from God. We are all sinners. We are all missing the mark. We are separating ourselves from God. But Jesus says, "I will come to you." He takes the initiative. On this day, as we continue in shelter in place, I want to underscore clearly that God's intervention into human history has made it possible for us to be restored into companionship and fellowship with God Himself and with each other. And when you understand that deeply, that truth will give you an energy and a hope to help you relate to your colleagues at work, or at the university, or with your family at home, or whoever you are, and in the process to help you bring others out of their loneliness. We may seldom or rarely reach the desperate point when we feel totally separated from God. We may never feel like the ancient mariner who drifted into the stagnant sea where neither God nor man gave any sign of life. Yet every one of us has been lonely. We've had dark days. And the sting of loneliness is just this threat of abandonment, the feeling there is no one in heaven or earth who cares. So, how do most of us cope with loneliness? Most of us try all kinds of methods and ways to cope with loneliness. First of all, we persistently try to seek a remedy for loneliness by trying not to be alone. We join clubs, we join a church, we do things in groups. Some go to bars to look for love in the wrong places because our basic instinct is for companionship. We build our houses in clusters, not too close to our neighbors, though that is debatable, and not too far away. Are you noticing that most of the housing that has been built in Fremont in the last 10 to 20 years are townhomes or apartments without lawns or alleys? We try not to be alone. Every time I go to New York City, and I used to live there, I am made dramatically aware of how men and women try not to be alone, and yet there are few places on earth where it is easier to be alone. You can wake to the chatter of the radio. You can herd together on the subways and buses. You can eat in crowded restaurants and drugstores, or we used to. Sit with a thousand of others in the dark anonymity of a movie house. Spend the evening at a party and fall asleep to the sound of the Late Late Show. And through it all, we can be more lonely than a shepherd on the Outer Hebrides or a lighthouse keeper off the coast of Maine, comfortless with all the comforts of our modern life. Lonely in the midst of a crowd of people, we try desperately not to be alone. Some people try not to be alone by watching TV. For many people, it is the link of communication to other people late at night, even though the show was taped earlier. Others listen to the radio or to their iPods or iPhones or on their computers. I often listen to radio or pop in a CD when I'm home alone or in the car. Background music, news, just to keep me company. None of us like to be alone. And unlike our predecessors of generations ago, we have many modern methods to keep us from being lonely. Some people cope with their loneliness by thinking they can escape with alcohol. Some take pills or drugs of some kind or another. I read a recent report by the American Medical Society which said that before you and I go to bed tonight, over 20 million sleeping pills will be consumed in the United States. Each year, over 12 million pounds of aspirin are used, and some 18 billion tablets, not including tranquilizers. Why? The article went on to say, because men and women are restless, lonely, impatient creatures. We don't know what to do when we are alone. I read this week several reviews of a book that was officially published just 10 days ago. The book is already creating quite a stir of interest. It's called Three Pieces of Glass: Why We Feel Lonely in a World Mediated by Screens. The author is Eric Jacobson, the senior pastor of the First Presbyterian Church in Tacoma, Washington. He shows how three pieces of glass, car windshields, TVs, and cell phones, these three are emblematic of significant cultural shifts that have created a societal habit of physical isolation. We feel increasingly disconnected from the people and places around us. He explains how adopting everyday practice and making changes in our neighborhoods can help us create a sense of belonging and rediscover what belonging used to be. I believe Three Pieces of Glass, the book, should be required reading for the leadership of our church because it aligns with our new mission statement of the church and it will help us to care more effectively about our community and literally with our neighbors. The book offers churches a deep well of imagination for how we can be catalysts for hope and belonging in a world that is dying, dying of loneliness. Here's another way to look at the pandemic of loneliness. Maybe the cure for loneliness is to be alone. Maybe what we need in our crowded and congested civilization in contemporary America is to learn how to be alone, to wait quietly, to be renewed in spirit, in solitude. That may be the gift of shelter in place. It was the American geologist James Percival who said, 1 hour of thoughtful solitude may nerve the heart for days of conflict, girding up its armor to meet the most insidious foe. One of the great motifs of the Old and New Testaments is to wait, to be still, to be patient. The 46th Psalm has in it a favorite verse of mine, "Be still and know that I am God." Moffat's translation of Psalm 46 goes like this: "Give in. Admit that I am God." The Message translation puts it this way: "Step out of the traffic. Take a long look at me, your high God, above politics, above everything." The Apostle Paul said, "Run, but run with patience." Jesus said, "Peace be unto you. Take no thought for tomorrow. Each day has enough troubles of its own. So don't be anxious. I will never leave you nor forsake you," he said. Powerful words. Another way people try to cure their loneliness is by running away from themselves. That is so often what we are doing in our constant sociability. We run away from ourselves because we're not quite sure who we really are and whether anybody cares. We are afraid to stop and look in case there is nobody there. When the prodigal son was in the far country with plenty of money, he would never be alone. He plunged from party to party, from thrill to thrill, surrounded by all the good time Charlies and the wannabe Bettys. But in the midst of that crowd, he was all alone and lost. When the money ran out, so did all his friends. He was lost, said Jesus, just as surely as the coin that rolled in the dark corner was lost, or as the sheep that wandered off from the flock on the mountainside. When the prodigal son's friends left, Jesus said, he came to himself. Now at last in rags and feeding from the trough with the swine, he was all alone, and for the first time he ceased to be lonely. For as he came to himself, there came to him the memory of his real home. The scripture says, and he arose and came to his father. And when he was yet a great way off, his father, who had been waiting and praying and hoping, saw him and had compassion and ran to him and fell on his knee, on his neck, and kissed him. "I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you." Sometimes we need to be alone to hear that voice, to know the presence that ends all loneliness. Now, I've presented four or five ways in which modern men and women try to cope with their loneliness, by joining groups, filling the silence with noise and radio and TV and CDs and iPhones and escaping with alcohol and drugs and trying to be not alone by running away from themselves. These have been suggested only to emphasize the third and major point of this sermon, namely that God's cure for loneliness is Jesus Christ. He is the ultimate cure for loneliness. I will never leave you. I will never leave you comfortless. I will come to you. However self-reliant and independent we become, we crave a presence that is not ourselves, sometimes someone somewhere who responds. We look for that. To be lonely may be only a passing mood, but deep down we know instinctively that to be ultimately lonely is to be lost. And only Christ can fill that void. Only Christ can restore us into fellowship with God and our fellow man. Christ is God's fulfillment for our loneliness. That is the first and most basic way to cope with loneliness. Remember, you are loved. So allow Christ to fill your life. You expect a pastor to say that, but it's true. I've seen too many people who have every reason to be desperate, whose experiences in life have left them abandoned, orphaned, but because they allowed Christ to take control of their lives, they have a radiance and a presence within which overcomes any hint at despair or frustration. So how do you do that? How do you allow Christ to fill your life? I'm going to suggest three ways. There are many more, but here are three. One, read the Bible daily. Read the Bible daily. Make it a part of your routine. I would venture to say that every person watching this service right now, you brush your teeth every morning, either before or after breakfast or both, and then right before you go to bed, right? I hope you also floss. It's just part of your daily habit. So should getting into God's Word. Make it a part of your daily routine, and while you're doing that, pray. What helped Paul get through each day when he was alone in prison? It was prayer. That's why he admonishes us to pray constantly. Pray without ceasing. Pray fervently throughout each day. It is in knowing Christ, in being loved by him, of sensing his living presence in your life that enables you and me to cope with our own loneliness. Allow Christ to fill your life. Invite him to allow him to be your partner, your close companion. Secondly, get connected to a life group. I learned this week that in Australia there is an organization called Prisms Network. PRISMS stands for Providing Resources for Independent Single Mothers After Separation. Many single mothers experience loneliness and sadness in the months following their decision or their partner's decision to separate. Often they feel isolated from their existing social or family network, and they may not want to branch out and meet other single mothers and forge new bonds with women in situations similar to theirs. That's where Prisms can help. They are setting up support groups in all the major cities of Australia to deal with loneliness. But you don't have to go to Australia. There are a number of life groups in this church. Groups for singles, groups for couples, groups for men, groups for women. And so if you're not yet part of a life group, join one today. We have Bible study groups, support groups, prayer groups. Are you part of one yet? Pastor Dennis Yim is your point person to help you get connected to a group. If there is anything that stands out as I've been meeting with the elders of this great church is that almost to a person, the thing that has strengthened their faith the most, that has deepened their spirituality, that has discipled them into leadership, has been their connection to a small life group. Some have been in a life group for 20 years. Some have just recently joined. So I urge you to get connected to a group. And during shelter in place, you can do it virtually through Zoom or some other platform. There really is no barrier to getting connected. Not only will you get it out of your funk of loneliness and mild depression, it will help you grow in your faith, in the study of God's word, and in the practical day-in, day-out way of life and faith that is pleasing to the Lord. It's a safe place to share your concerns, a place of accountability, a place of Bible study, and a place for great fellowship, wholesome fun, and a time of vital prayer. We have seen miracles happen in the life groups Christina and I have been connected with because of the relationships, because of the prayers that are offered to the Lord. You want to get rid of loneliness? Get connected to a life group here at CPC. The third way to find the cure for loneliness is so basic. It's this: get over yourself and help somebody else. Volunteer. If you are experiencing loneliness, help someone else. You'll discover your problems are a lot less than you think they are. Focusing on the needs of others steers your mind away from sad thoughts and self-pity. It's impossible to feel lonely when you are helping to feed the homeless, or when you're reading to kids after school or at an orphanage, or dancing with grandmothers at a salsa class. When our travel restrictions are lifted, maybe you could sign up for a short mission trip. Helping the less fortunate will also fill you with immense gratitude and give you a perspective that can transform your life. This is where the church has real meaning. This is where it comes alive. By your giving, by your sharing as a community of faith, your efforts can be multiplied with others to be of help to people in real need. Jesus said this: "He who saves his own life will lose it, but he who loses his life in service to others will find it." Alfred Adler, the famous psychologist, once put an ad in the paper for his 14-day cure plan. He claimed that he could cure anyone of any mental or emotional difficulty in just 14 days if they would do just what he told them to do. One day, a woman who was extremely lonely came to see Adler. He told her he could cure her of her loneliness in just 14 days if she would just simply follow his advice. She was not very enthusiastic, but she still asked, what do you want me to do? Adler replied, "If you will do something for someone else for 14 days consistently, at the end of that time, your loneliness will be gone." She objected profusely. "Why should I do anything for someone else? Nobody ever does anything for me." Adler supposedly responded jokingly, "Well, maybe it will take you 21 days. We influence people by relating to them, being present for them one at a time. And that takes patience. It takes time. It takes love. By reaching out and helping someone else in need, by being a steady source of strength and support, you will not only help them to get rid of loneliness, but in the process, you will be healed. you will be healed and helped yourself. Amen? Let us pray. Dear Lord, forgive us when we are so absorbed with ourselves and filled with anxiety, especially now with all the uncertainty of the economy and personal income for many, and the fear of coronavirus and all the other news that is confusing and contradictory, making it difficult even to believe whom to believe. Dear Lord, give us wisdom and the confidence in you that you will never leave us or forsake us. Enlarge our faith and trust in you to provide so that we can be servant leaders in our community, bringing hope and the joy of the gospel to neighbors and families, wherever we may be. We pray this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Thomas Benuelos and Eden Mercado will lead us in our concluding song, I Am Not Alone.
When I walk through deep waters, I know that you will be with me. When I'm standing in the fire, I will not be overcome.
I am not alone.
Thank you, Tomas and Eden. I'm amazed at how that thought, that promise, begins back in the very beginning of the Old Testament. As God said to Joshua, "As I was with Moses, so I will be with you, Joshua. I will not leave you nor forsake you. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." And Jesus said, "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come to you." Friends, be strong. Go in peace. Be a blessing to someone else this week. Hallelujah. Amen.
Hi, this is Elder Leonard here, and I just wanted to go over a couple things with you at the end of the service, things about giving with you. And first of all, we want to really thank you for your faithfulness and your generosity as you've been giving through this time. And we want to highlight again that you can go online and give at cpcfremont.org. When you go there at the top, you'll see a menu item that says giving. You just need to click in there. If it's your first time, you'll have to register. But after that, you can go and give. And if you could sign up for Zoom, if you can sign up to buy things on Amazon.com, then you can sign up to give online. It's that easy. And we especially want to highlight that while you're doing that, we want to make special note of our Deacons Fund. Many of you know our Deacons Fund helps support the financial needs of those who have special needs in our congregation. Now, we've done that in the past, but now especially as we're going through this, we have some people who have some special needs. So we hope you'll consider going and donating online and giving to the Deacons Fund. And we greatly appreciate it. And those that are being helped appreciate it greatly. Thank you for your support. And then just finally, we're going to send you off into some breakout rooms so you can chat and discuss with some of our fellow church members. So enjoy that time together. We'll leave the breakout room open for about 15 minutes where you can chat and say hi to some people that maybe you haven't seen in a while. So thank you for worshiping with us, and thank you for being a part of our community. Thanks.